share with God's people and see what God has for us today. I hope this has been a great week for you. Concerning our announcements today, search committee will meet at 2 o'clock today. Search committee meeting at 2. Pray for our search committee as we seek God's leadership and in the future of our church. Birthdays, Andrea Moore and Collis Cornett. Anyone else have something to celebrate today? Okay. May we celebrate being here. Wherever you are listening, if it's in person on CD or YouTube or wherever, pray that the Lord will speak to you and meet your needs. So let's begin our morning of worship as we bow together, please. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love, for your presence. We thank you for your house. In the Old Testament, the Psalms, they were so delighted to go into the house of the Lord. And they rejoiced, Father, as they lifted up your name. We do the same today, but in the name of Jesus Christ. And we pray that he will be glorified and that we'll get a new insight into your word, your will for our lives. Whoever's listening to this message, we pray during this worship service, their hearts will be touched, encouraged, and blessed. We just give you the glory for whatever happens today, Father. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Praise to the Lord.
That's what we're going to do now.
So let's just stand up and praise our great and mighty God. First and foremost, please.
Settled in Michigan and doing well with her family. Please pray for my brother Ronnie, who is still in ICU in the hospital. So pray for him as he is suffering with COVID. And they said if he did not get his oxygen up more with the face mask, they'd have to put him on the ventilator. So please pray for him, Ronnie. Anyone else have someone on their hearts this morning? Or something else you'd like to pray about or share about? Maybe an answered prayer. Anyone got something to share this morning? Anyone you'd like to pray for? Okay, I'd like to do this a little bit different. I'm going to have a time of silence. And I'd like to give you the opportunity to pray. If you'd like to see it, like to stand where you are, say a few words of prayer. And however you feel led, and I will close after I feel like everyone's had an opportunity. May we pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the quietness of this moment. It's been the quietest time that some of us have spent all week. Many people are so busy, 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 going and doing that they don't have time or don't take the time to be holy, to try to take some time in a private place to talk with you. We know that's where our power comes from, our leadership, our guidance, and our fellowship with you. So give us a burden to spend more time with you, Father. How we love you, Lord, and we thank you for all the ways that you've blessed us. You've answered prayers. You intervened this week in so many ways that we don't even know about. You may have saved our life from getting hit head on in a car or hitting someone else. There's hundreds of things that could have happened to us, but you spared our lives, and we thank you for that. Others who are suffering, Father, in ways that we can't understand or imagine, we pray for them. Pray that your hand, as the great physician, will be extended and touch their lives, because prayer can go where we can't go, and you can always go everywhere. So we pray that you will meet the needs of our family, our loved ones, and even our neighbors and strangers that we meet. We pray that we will be sensitive to your presence in our life and our guidance. And when we feel that you bring someone to our mind to pray about, to call, to talk to stop in some area of life during the week, we pray that we will be bold enough to do that and carry on a conversation with them and talk to them and pray that you'll open the door that we can share your message, your love. And may we just be understand that we're a walking sermon wherever we go, the way that we talk to people, the way we treat them. And everything that we do, Father, it represents you. So may we be careful in how we live. And may it be said of us that it was said of your Son, Father, that he went about doing good. And help us to do the same thing. We pray for Ronnie this morning that you'll bless him, you'll encourage him, you'll heal him, you'll take care of him and his family, and bless them at this time. Our church family, we pray that you will bless, that you will encourage, and that you'll be with our search committee, each member, and that you'll be with us, dear God, and give insight, and that you will give guidance and help us to make the right decisions, sometimes the hard decisions, but all of them will be to glorify you and be what's best for this church and this ministry and this community. We just pray, dear God, even though we're few, that we can be many in your power, in your service. So may we be faithful today in worship. And as we leave this place, we'll be faithful in service. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Greatest gift God ever gave us was Jesus. We cannot any of us deny that and how precious he is to all of us. So let's just stand and sing about the fairest Lord Jesus. Page 176. Hadn't sung this one in a long time, but today's the day. Thank you.
If you have your Bibles, please turn to 1 Peter 4, 7 through 11. 1 Peter 4, 7 through 11. As I preach today concerning prepping for Jesus' return. The end of all things is near. Therefore be sound judgment, sober spirit, for the purpose of prayer. Above all, keep fervent in your love for one another, because love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaint. As each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Whoever speaks is to do so as one who is speaking the utterances of God. Whoever serves is to do so as one who is serving by the strength which God supplies, so that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom belongs the glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. We pray, dear God, that it will have its way in our hearts and our lives, that we'll have our spiritual ears and eyes open. Teach us, Father. Teach us things that we do not know. May they encourage us and bless us and help us to do your will and be faithful to you today and following you. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. You've probably seen through the years, either in person or on TV or in the newspaper, this man who walks around on some of the largest cities,
and their streets.
He has a sign on his back, or either's holding a sign that says, "The end is near," or "Prepare for the end of the world." I'm sure that man has been mocked thousands of times. But someday people will be saying, "I wish I had taken seriously the man with the sign on his back, and I wish I could talk to him about what his message conveyed." There's a whole industry built around preparing for a catastrophe that would destroy all human race, or at least life in America as we know it. Stephen Davey, pastor of the Shepherd's Church in the Shepherd's Seminary, Theological Seminary in Cary, North Carolina, is one of my favorite preachers and teachers. I just learned about him a few years ago. Now listen to his messages on YouTube, and also Wisdom of the Heart is his radio program. And on a recent Bible study, he spotlights a famous TV show, Doomsday Preppers. How many of you ever heard of that? Doomsday Preppers. Oh, well, you've missed a good show. I haven't seen it much, but I've seen a little bit of it to know what it's about. Doomsday Preppers and many shows that it has spawned since it's been on TV teaches how to survive when our society collapses. The popular TV show has prompted the sale of everything related to preparing for the breakdown of our society, such as underground bunkers, water purifiers, air filtration systems, how to generate power and lights, and how to preserve food for years, and how to defend yourself when people are trying to break into your house and steal what you have been prepping for and keeping and saving for a long time. There's nothing wrong with being prepared, is it? We all try to prepare. My daughter recently bought a car, and I looked in the trunk, and it didn't have a spare tire. Well, the only thing it did have was that little bitty donut of a tire and wheel. And so I went and bought her a real wheel and a real tire, just like you put on the car to keep in the trunk, because she drives 3.5 hours from us. And if she had a flat, I didn't want her to have to try to drive home on that little donut of a tire that you're supposed to only not drive over 45 miles per hour.
So I thought a real tire would be much safer. So I was preparing. But if you're going to be a true prepper and prep for the end of the world to come, it's going to take a lot of money, a lot of time, a lot of space, and a lot of effort to prepare for the end of the world. Pastor David said something that I've never heard before, but I think it's true. He's got biblical evidence. And he says, strangely, the Bible never calls for us to prepare for a natural disaster that will threaten to destroy the whole world or country where we cannot function. So the preppers are really wasting time. But we may run out of toilet paper. That's me saying, not David. Pam told me a few days ago, she said, I was watching news and you know that there's going to be a shortage on everything, especially during the holidays. So in the next day or so, I call Alex Stryker. And I say, Alex, do not go to Walmart before I get a chance to go there and buy my paper products. Because I knew Alex would go and wipe the place out. And buy the place out. And he laughed and said, I didn't even know we were going to have a shortage. So it's good that I called him, wasn't it? In verse 7 it says, the end of all things is near. There will be an end to this age. There will be an end to the church age. I pray that the Lord doesn't come back quickly so we will have more time to get more people saved before the end of the time, before the end of the world is coming and Christ comes back. The earth will be destroyed, but you can't prep for that disaster when the Lord comes back. God will destroy everything by fire. The Bible says God will create a new earth and he will return for his church and we Christians will be taken away to heaven, up in the air with him, where we will not live in a bunker, but that we will live in a mansion with him forever and ever that he has promised us. The end of this age is prominent in the writings of Peter and James and Hebrew and Mark and Matthew and Apostle Paul's letters and in the book of Revelation. Most of the New Testament writers challenge Christians with a bold preparedness for the return of Christ. Most of us Christians believe in the signs and times are certainly setting and getting right and setting a stage for the Christ return anytime. That's why Peter sounds the alarm also. But he sounded it 2,000 years ago, the end of all things is near. All of the apostles, they lived like Jesus was coming back in their lifetime. And he just may come back in our lifetime also. So for us Christians, more importantly than how to purify muddy water so we can drink it as clean water, a more responsible and more important to us is how should we live as Christians before Christ returns? How should we prep? How should we prepare for the coming of our Lord? Most of us Christians that I talk to, see in the last years, things have changed so drastically. And there's so much craziness, so much violence, there's a greater love for everything in our world today besides God than it ever has been. So many of us feel, like I'm sure many of you, that our Lord will return soon. Our short text today in 1 Peter 4, 7 through 11 commands us how to live until Jesus returns. Verse 7 again, the end of all things is near, therefore be of sound judgment and sober spirit for the purpose of prayer. Be calm. Stay cool. Gather your wits around you. Keep your wits when everyone else is losing theirs. Maintain self-control is what Peter is saying. But it's hard to maintain control when you're filled with drama. Do any of you have any drama in your life? I think we all do. If you ever get on Facebook and any of social media, you'll see how much drama that there is all of the time on social media. The reality shows that people watch. The news. The news is not news anymore. It's just sensational entertainment with a little news sprinkled in. Glenn Beck, who used to be on TV but now is on radio, has a book entitled Addicted to Outrage. And he says, unless you've been living under a rock for the past 20 years, you're probably addicted to expressing outrage at everyone and everything that is different from ourselves is our new favorite national pastime. It's an epidemic worse and more insidious than our growing crisis of drug addiction, far worse than our addiction to caffeine or sugar or fast food, because our outrage addiction is destroying our nation. Everyone is mad about something, it seems. Everyone is trying to either cause trouble or find out who caused trouble and bring judgment upon them. There's always drama on TV, the newspaper. Well, did you hear what she said? Did you see what he did? Did you hear about what our city, our state, our government is going to do? And it's easy to see why we live in so much drama and anxiousness and why everybody is angry about something. What is the problem? Why is there a problem? Drama keeps us from praying. That's why Peter says, be in control, have a sound mind, be of sober spirit, be calm, be cool, be clear-headed, watch and wait and listen and be in control of your emotions and what you do and what you say and what you think. And let God be in control of all of it that you might spend time praying. Drama keeps us from praying because drama drains us emotionally where we have nothing left. No energy, no desire, no responsibility, no discipline in praying. When churches get into conflict, that's all they do is fight. The statistics are that we're supposed to spend 80% of our time in missions, evangelism, and caring for one another and the rest of the world. And 20% of the time we spend in administration, solving the problems, and getting back to work on the 80%. But when a church starts fighting and has conflict, that flip-flops. Then they spend only 20% of their time in missions, in evangelism, in outreach, and they spend 80% of their time in conflict and fighting, and it drains them. Things can happen in the congregation. There can be domestic violence in a family that spills over into the church. There can be a van crash and someone is hurt or killed in the van, and it drains the church of its energy. The last part of verse 7, it says, have sound judgment, sober spirit, for the purpose of prayer. Be alert so that you'll be able to pray. It is the power of prayer that helps us to handle crisis in the first place. But we're so stressed out, have so much drama in our life, then we can't handle our crisis because we can't spend time praying. Alan Stibbs in Tyndale New Testament commentary, he says, it may be that Peter was thinking about the time he fell asleep when Jesus was praying in the garden. Remember Jesus going to the garden and praying? He says, you men, you stay here and watch and pray while I go yonder and pray. And he went and prayed to the Father. Praying to one of the most important prayers in all of his life. To seek God's will and to follow him and obey him that he might go to the cross and die for our sins that we might have salvation. Pretty important, don't you think? Looks like the disciples would have been just and much fever praying for Jesus at this time. But they were asleep. And when Jesus came back from praying, he says, couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour? Just 1 hour. And then he says, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. Peter should have really been praying because he fell into temptation. Now I think the churches have been asleep at the wheel many times when there's been crises in our churches, in our communities, in our world, and we have been asleep instead of praying for God to intervene. Prayer is the most important thing we can do. Or is it? Look in verse 8. Above all, now he just said that prayer was most important. Therefore, the end of the world is near. Therefore, I want you to pray. But he says in verse 8, above all, keep fervent in your love for one another. Keep fervent. Work at it. Strain at it like an athlete. Make it important and disciplined to love one another. Love one another deeply. We represent Jesus the most when we love more than anything else. Even more than when we preach or teach or when we carry a basket of fruit or visit somebody in the hospital or do work around the church or do missions. Loving, we show Jesus more than any other way, for God is love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. The greatest commandment, love God with all of our heart, our strength, and our soul, and to love our neighbors, ourselves. And then John 13, 35, it says, by this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. Not that you paint the church and keep the facilities up. Not that you keep the van polished. Not that you keep the flowers watered out front to look nice for the visitors. Not that you have concerts and programs that reaches the community and the world. Even though all of those things are nice, but it's love that is most important for us to show each other and the world. Apostle Paul said, "Do not have if you do not have love, it profits you nothing." Paul says it profits me nothing. If I can do this and I have all these skills and talents and so forth, but without love, it's useless. Davy says once again that emphasis for doomsday preppers is on self. Never thought about that, but that's true. The doomsday preppers, those who are prepping for the end of the year, are concerned about who? Not their neighbors, but themselves. They fortify their house to keep the neighbors out. They build bunkers so that they can hide. They build storage bins for their food and their water and what they'll need in the future. Not to help their neighbors, but to help themselves. And I'm sure that some share, but by and large, it's for themselves. But listen to what Apostle Paul says in Philippians 2, 1 through 4. Therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, if there is any consolation of love, if there is any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection, compassion, make my joy complete by being of the same mind, maintaining the same love. United in spirit, you intent on one purpose. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. Now, wouldn't that cure a host of problems in our marriages, in our families, in our churches, in our government, if we were more concerned about other people's interests and their needs than we are our own? Why is it so important for Christians to show God's love in this end time? Because it shows that we're different. That we're not like the rest of the world. As there's more crisis and craziness, who will these people that are filled with anxiety, stricken, who will they turn to? Other crazy people? Other people that are filled with anxiety and don't want to listen? And nobody wants to listen to you today. If you find somebody that wants to listen to you, then you'll stand there and you'll talk to them for a long time. I've met strangers or people at the gas pump and say, "How you doing?" And for you, and then I've already filled up with gas and I'm just going to get $10 worth, and I've already stood there and filled it up because I was listening to this guy. People want to share what's on their heart and their mind. There's people that will spot us out, and they will see that we are calm and cool and collected. And we're not all the time, but that's the goal, isn't it? That we might be in control of ourselves. And when people are in crisis and need help, they're going to come to us who seem to have an answer. And we don't have the answer to everything, but at least we can listen. And Paul says we are to carry each other's burdens. That's one way to care, is to listen as people share their problems with us. Be in control, be calm, trust God, and pray for love, and to pray that we will love our neighbors as ourselves. In the last part of verse 8, it says, because love covers a multitude of sins. Love forgives. If we have love in our heart, we will forgive other people. No matter what the history in our life, in our family, in our church, our community, among politics, among countries, if there is love, we can forgive, and we need to forgive. Forgive the sins of others, because we all need a second chance. Remember, Jesus said 70 times 70? We all need a second chance and a third chance, because we goof up, we mess up, we're sinners. And the reason that we act like we do is because we're sinners. And we need forgiveness. We need love. Love is patient. Patient with those who are anxious. Patient with those who are frightened. Patient with those who make crazy and dumb decisions. Patient because we all make the wrong decisions. Love is kind and tender-hearted. Give others grace. What a great gift we can give other people who say the wrong thing, who are discourteous and rude and so forth, whether it be driving or at a restaurant or shopping or whatever, to give them grace. Try to love them, forgive them. The same grace that God gave us, the same grace He wants us to share until He comes. I'm going to skip verse 9 and go to verse 10 and come back tonight. As each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Serve one another in order to glorify God. Whatever we do, do it for the glory of God. I was out walking Falco this morning, my dog, our dog. And there's a guy down at the big church, two houses down, and then the big church, old South Fork Baptist Church that is now Revo Church. And he was out there blowing the leaves off in front of the church. I don't know if that's his job or whether he just felt it needed to be done or whether that's his gift or whatever, but he was doing it and it needed to be done, and he was doing it, I'm sure, for the glory of God. Whatever we do for the glory of God and use our gifts and just help. If everybody just pitched in and helped. You know how many times I've heard that through my years as a pastor in churches? If everybody would just do it a little bit, but it's the same people that do the same things all of the time. Isn't that sad? What a great mystery it is to why church people can't do just a little bit. Everybody, I mean. Everyone. It would be so helpful to the body of Christ. Customer service is gone in America, and what is left ain't much. There's a few people that do right. that give good customer service, that really puts a spotlight on the customer and tries to help. But it's obvious that a lot of people working seem not to care about their job or the people that they're working with. I think that many of our workers are spoiled in society, and they've been given too much, and they take for granted that they got a job. There's a lot of people that would love to have a job, love to have a job, the job that that person has that doesn't really care about their job. Oh, they want to be paid, but they don't want to work. They don't want to make a difference in their job for the company that they work for. I like to go to Chick-fil-A, and every time they wait on you, and every time you say thank you, and they say, oh, it is my pleasure. It is my pleasure. It is my pleasure to serve you. Wonder what the world would think if the Christians would say that. If the Christians act like, it is a pleasure for me to help you and to be of service to you and to be kind to you and to share love and forgiveness and be tenderhearted and helpful to you. How can we senior citizens serve and use our gifts? He says here is in verse 10, as each one has received a special gift. He didn't say spiritual gift, he said a special gift. So it could be a spiritual gift, it could be a talent, it could be a skill, it could be something that you just do better or enjoy doing more than other people. But it's a special gift that God gave you, because all good things come down from above, James says. Whether it's a spiritual gift or whatever, we can interact with people with our gifts, whether it's a hobby or an interest. And we talk to those people about those things. About a hobby. It doesn't have to be about the plan of salvation. But we talk to them about a hobby and interest that we have with that we know that they have. And we make a connection and we begin to build a relationship. And it gives us the opportunity for God to open up a door where we can share deeply about the things of God. It happens so many times. Seniors can listen. Here's some things that seniors can do. All seniors, no matter what age we are. We can listen, we can care, and we can help. Might not be able to bend over and change a tire, but we can help direct traffic, or we can call 911, or we can be there with them until they get it changed. Little things, we've got to start looking at people in our community, our neighborhood, and people that we pass. People that have a handful of groceries and they're trying to open the door to the grocery store and to get out. It'd be helpful to someone to open the door for them. It's just a simple thing that we take for granted. But people do not do it enough. And when we do something that reflects our concern and care for other people, they will take notice. We can all be a handyman or a handy woman. And we can befriend others by sharing whatever we have, whether it's our talent or hobby, and pray that God will use it to minister to them. Find some little way that will emphasize God and His Son in these crazy times, and praying to God, to them, as one who can comfort them and be a blessing to them. In verse 11 it says, whoever speaks is to do so as one who is speaking the utterances of God, the teaching of God, the word of God. Whoever serves is to do so as one who is serving, by the strength which God supplies, so that all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom belongs the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Talk to others about God. Ask God for an opportunity to share His word. Talk about godly things, spiritual things. If you want to call them church things. But try to direct the conversation to say something about your faith, about God, that other people will pick up on, and some people will pick up on it, and they'll ask you questions, or they'll share their faith. It's always good to meet a stranger who you find out is a Christian. You got something that is quickly so much in common that you can talk about and Say, I'll pray, glad to meet you, and I'll pray for you. And they may even bring up a concern or something that is bothering them. Now, there'll be some people that would just cut you off and start talking about somebody, something else, because you bring up something spiritual. But that's okay. We're not going to win them all. Not everyone is going to heaven. Not everyone is coming to church. Not everyone is going to be excited and love and appreciate Jesus Christ like we do. But that's okay. As I said, was it last week, to shake the dust off your feet and go to the next town, go to the next person? Because there is low-hanging fruit. And the fruit is ripe for harvest. There are people out there looking for a word from God, for someone to love them, encourage them, and be a blessing to them. Ask the questions. I hear a lot of people talking about the end times, that the Lord may be coming back soon. What do you think about that? I've heard a lot of people talk about that. It's a good conversation starter. Start one for Jesus and see what happens. The last verse, verse 9, let's go back to 9. Be hospitable to one another without complaint. People aren't quite as hospitable as they used to be because we don't have porches and we don't have rocking chairs and we don't meet on the porch and we don't say, come over and we'll talk and we'll core an apple or make ice cream or whatever. We don't do that anymore. Sad, but we don't visit like we used to visit. Church people don't invite people out to eat or the preacher out to eat anymore. Hint, hint. Used to be when I first went into the ministry, they always was asking me to go out and eat with them. And I did a lot. But it's a hot way of hospitality for a lot of people that we don't do today. But preparing for the end of time, Jesus' return, is by being hospitable to one another. Now, hospitality today is different than it was in New Testament. When someone needed a place to stay in the New Testament, they stayed, they took them in. They may stay a week, a month, a year, or like even Apostle Paul stays a couple years somewhere while he comes to minister. He just makes himself at home. But that's the way that they did it. I remember my first church at Roseland, Virginia, Jonesboro Baptist Church. They had a great flood there in 68, I believe it was, and hundreds of people's lives were lost. And so many of them were scattered without moms and dads or husbands or wives. And many of them moved in with neighbors and other friends. Or other kids they talk about, say, oh, that's old so-and-so. He came to live with us when he was just a teenager. He's been with us nearly all of his life. And he left, got married, and so forth. But they took people in, was hospitable. We don't do that today. One reason, because we watch too much TV and we've heard too much and we're afraid to even open the door, much less have someone over for dinner. But we should, if the Lord leads us, to have someone over for dinner, to talk with them, to minister to them, we should do it. Don't hide in the cave. Don't hide in the cave and don't store up pounds of beef jerky. Get out and meet people and invite people over. Ask God in these last days, as it said, as Peter said, the end of all things is near. How can I make a difference in these last days? What can I do? That'd be a good prayer for all of us. What can we do in these last days? Look at our church. Doesn't it look like the last days? Many churches are struggling. But we still need to ask, what would God have me to do in these last days to minister? I want to close by telling you a story that I heard. David told this story in some sermon some time ago. I can't remember which one. But he tells about an elderly lady who got saved. And she goes to the pastor and she asks him, she says, I got saved, preacher, and I want to serve the Lord now. Never served him all of my life, and with what years I have left, I want to serve the Lord. What should I do? And he gave a common pastoral advice. He said, we just go pray about it. When preachers don't know what to do, what to say, they just say, well, you just need to pray about it. So she did. She went home and she prayed about it. And she lived close by a large university. And she made up these little cards, like business cards. And she went to the university and she placed them on the bulletin boards for jobs and information and so forth. And the only thing on the card it said was, if you are lonely, come for tea. And had her address. Well, she goes home the next day, she makes tea, she makes some little cakes, some little sweets, and she waited. No one showed up. She waited the next day, and the next day, and no one showed up. She waited a few weeks, and no one showed up. But one day, someone came to her door and knocked on her door, and she opened the door, and there stood a young man from the Asian persuasion. And he was sort of nervous and didn't know what to think when he opened the door and saw her. But she was so charming, so loving, that he just relaxed, came in the house, enjoyed a cup of hot tea with her, and had a dessert. And he enjoyed himself. He said, she looked just like my grandma. Well, he goes back to the campus and he begins to tell people, there's this little lady that looks just like my grandma and your grandma, and she has hot tea and she has some good things to eat. Won't you come over and we'll visit her? So they did. And they told their friends about it. And their friends told their friends about it. And before you know it, she had a line of people coming to her home. And she did that for years. And when she died, they said it almost shut down the university. They had her funeral, and they had 70 honorable pallbearers to follow her to the grave. She had made such an impact on those young people's life by giving them hot tea, just a little sweet, and sharing her love for Jesus with them. And many of them come to know Jesus also. A simple act of love and faith. She did what she could do in her later years, and what a difference she made. She did what she could do, and she didn't copy somebody else. She just did in her own heart what she thought that she could do that might be special and might glorify God and be a witness to other people. She didn't multitask and have a bunch of stuff and have programs printed up and do this and have someone to come and sing while she did. No. She just served tea and sweets. She did what she could do. She opened more than her home. She opened her heart. She shared her love for Jesus. Will you open your heart today in this end of time? The end of all things is near, says Peter. I believe it, don't you? The end is near. The end is near. Let us open our hearts and be open to God and His leadership and whatever He wants us to do to be a witness to Him, to glorify Him. Would you bring that to the altar today and ask God to begin to work in your own heart and life that you might be faithful, responsible in doing whatever He wants you to do for Him. Trust and obey, and that's certainly our invitational hymn, but it's certainly what we need to do, is to trust and obey. Would you stand together as Darlene plays and as God speaks, and as we make the decision that He has laid on our heart today. If you have a burden, you need to pray, come to the altar. If you'd like for me to pray with you, please come. Or if you'd like to pray where you are, please do as we stand and sing. Trust in as Darlene plays, and we think about what God has already told us through the service. Thank you.
what would we do? What would we change? Who would we call? What decision would we make? Let's do it this week, because he may come back this week. May we pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for the promise that you are going to return for us, that you're going to take us home with you. We look forward to that day. But until then, may we be faithful in obeying you and serving you and following you. In Christ's name, and we glorify you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.